Good morning, church. We're so glad that you're here this morning. If you would be able to, please stand. And we're doing a new song this morning called Be Glad, and it's based on 1 Chronicles 16:34. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let's praise.
From glory to dancing, from Good morning and welcome. If you happen to be a first-time visitor, thank you for being brave and coming to check us out. We're glad you're here. To all of you who are here and you folks watching online, thank you for choosing to begin your week worshiping the Lord with us here at Open Door Christian Church. To let you know, it's Communion Sunday. If you're at home, this is a chance to get something for bread and for juice to share in communion a little later on. It is also Youth Takeover Sunday, the second part of the service. Some of our young people from the Wednesday night worship team are actually going to be up here leading in worship. So it's going to be a fun morning. We got all kinds of stuff going on. Last Sunday, if you happened to miss it or if you didn't hear about it, we were not here for church. Did anybody actually show up here for church last? Good. I didn't ask last service. I'm glad you didn't. We were at the high school, Newland Spicer High School. We were in the main gym. And we've got some pictures in case you were not there with us. This is the way that we celebrated the resurrection of Jesus last week. Those are the cards that we sent out to everybody. That was after the chairs had been put down and set up. What you maybe didn't know is there was a cross in the chairs that was set up by color. Moved everything for technology, music, everything that we needed, soundboard, cameras, everything. We moved into the main gym. They put up a platform for us, worship team rehearsing. And there it is starting to fill up. Whole lot of praying going on that morning, I'll tell you what. And then there it was when everybody was in there. It was full. It was awesome. So thank you for coming out. It was kind of our pioneering moment. I wonder if this is going to work. I wonder if God's going to bless us and there's actually going to be people here. And God was awesome. God is at work in the communities of New London and Spicer and the area around us, and we get to be a part of it. So thank you for all of those who volunteered, who helped out in any way. It took dozens and dozens and dozens of people starting many days ahead of time to pull that all off. And so thank you. A lot of faces I didn't even know, and so people from the community were there, and that was really the whole goal, was to go to where the people are and where the people get. And so thank you for making that happen, and go God for making it an awesome morning. If this is your first time here, you might wonder what you're in for. Well, here's the deal. There's three things we do our very best to get right every Sunday. First of all of our messages come straight out of God's Word. We believe the Bible is as relevant today as the days that it was written. We're starting a new series in the book of 1 John this morning. Second thing is prayer. During the service, you may see in the back corners or after the service up front, there's lights. Those lights are on that illuminate a sign that says prayer. There is somebody there that is waiting and willing to pray with you or to pray for you. Anything that you share with them is strictly confidential. They don't repeat it to anybody. Third thing is worship. These folks are here, and the young people later are here to lead us in worship. We have the opportunity to worship for an audience of one, and that is our Father who is in heaven. So with that, let's open with a word of prayer. Gracious God, thank you for the gift of this new day. Thank you for the rain that we need. The farmers need it. Our land needs it. The grass needs it. The woods need it. God, thank you for the rain. Even though it maybe is a little inconvenient, it is good to know that you're replenishing the earth. And God, thank you for that incredible celebration that we were able to have to remember and to honor you and remember what Jesus did for us in dying on the cross and when you raised him from the grave, that we could have our sins forgiven and we could live forever with you. God, thank you for the chance to worship and to celebrate where we did. We ask now that as we gather here in this place, God, that your Holy Spirit would be with us, that he would fill this room, that he would be present everywhere, that anyone is watching. We just want you to know that we invite your Holy Spirit, God. You send him wherever it is that you want him to be, but God, we want you to know that he is welcome here. We just ask that all that we do in this time, God, knowing that you set divine appointments for your people, whether it's our 100th time or our first, there is a reason that you have gathered every one of us. And so we ask in the power of your Holy Spirit that you would make that reason known to us, that you would make yourself known to us. God, we take this time now and we give it to you and pray that it's to your greatest glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue to worship.
Come on, you sinners, come Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. I love that worship song. Good morning, church family. My name is Chris Eckhoff, and my husband and I have been coming to the Open Door Church for about 9 years. And during that time, I've served on various ministries. I've served coffee, I've been a greeter, and for 4 years, I did the communion prep. And so I sliced the bread and poured the wine and juice for us each month. If you've never had the opportunity to be on a ministry team, I highly encourage you to do that. It's a great way to develop Christian relationships with others, serve the Lord, and you will find he blesses you through that. So today we are going to share in Holy Communion. If you are joining us online, now's the time to gather something for bread and juice. If you're here live, I'll invite you forward in a few moments. Jesus himself is the one who commanded us to remember his death, and Holy Communion is the way he instructed us to do that. Communion is when we remember that Jesus gave his life in obedience to God and a sign of God's great love. During the next song, I will invite you to come forward to receive communion. The dark liquid is wine, and the light-colored liquid is grape juice. Or if you would prefer a communion pack, those are in the silver buckets on the outside edges. Communion servers, would you please come forward? In the night in which our Lord was betrayed, he gathered for the Last Supper with his disciples. He took bread, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you." He went on and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shared for you and for many. Do this in memory of me." Would you please join me in reciting the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Communion is ready. Please come forward when you are.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wondered how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean, singing, "How marvelous, shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me." I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus. Singing, "How marvelous, how..." You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart.
Thank you.
pray. God, we sing those words because we believe they're true. Great are you, Lord. Great are you. You are worthy of all of our worship and praise. And we're going to take a look at 1 John starting today, God. And one of the things that he reminds us of is it's easy to believe and to know that you are great. It's something different to live our lives in a way that showed that that's what we believe and who we are. So God, I just pray that you would open our ears and our hearts and our minds to your word this morning, not to my words, but to your word, to the words that you had the Apostle John write down that we're able to have recorded in your word to read 2,000 years later today. So God, we just take this time and we ask that you would bless us with an understanding of who you are and how it is that you want us to live as your people. God, we give you thanks. As we celebrate Holy Communion, we give you thanks for doing for us through Jesus what we could not do for ourselves. It's in his name that we pray, amen. You may be seated. So we're going to spend a few weeks on the New Testament book of 1 John. All the way towards the end, if you've got your Bibles, it's all the way towards the end, just before the book of Revelation. 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. Why? It fits really, really well, and you'll find that out right away today. It fits really well after Resurrection Sunday and the things that we celebrate on Resurrection Sunday, but it also fits really well at the end of our Pioneer Spirit, our series on the Pioneer Spirit and how it is that we have this relationship with God that God wants us to bring out into the world that we don't keep for ourselves, but that we share it with everybody who will listen to us. If you're new to the Christian faith or you're trying to decide if it's where you really want to go and who you want to be, this little book is a great starting point. It gives you a great understanding of who Jesus is from a guy who actually knew him personally. If you are a mature Christian, because next week he's going to start talking about that, being young in the faith and mature in the faith. Maybe you've been in the faith for a while. It is a great refresher and it's a great reminder. So 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, the Gospel of John, and the book of Revelation, all written by the same guy. Some people say, oh, Paul wrote the whole New Testament outside the Gospels. No, he didn't. John wrote three small books that were specific letters to a church. And then he wrote the Gospel of John, which was his time understanding and talking about the life of Jesus. And then he wrote the book of Revelation, all written by the same guy. John was one of the original 12 disciples. He was one of the guys that Jesus chose to be there, right there with him. The Bible tells us that there's two sons of Zebedee, one James and one John. So two brothers served as Jesus' disciples. John is the only disciple outside of Judas who took his own life not to suffer martyrdom for the faith. Now, it wasn't they didn't try. Martyrdom just simply means that all the other disciples were killed because of their belief in Jesus. They thought if they silenced the people who were preaching, they could silence the faith. This thing still happens today around the world. If you could silence the people who are bold enough to speak, maybe we can shut the faith down. But those disciples just kept telling what they knew and what they'd experienced with Jesus. But they tried to take out John. He had been sentenced to being boiled. This is just horrible. He'd been sentenced to being boiled to death in a vat of hot oil. And apparently they tossed him in and he walked away from the experience unhurt and lived to be an old man. He was supposed to have been martyred with all the rest of them, but he didn't. And so the book of John is written by this guy who's a disciple, who was willing to give his life for the faith. He was an apostle and a missionary of a sort, but also he was a pastor. And by the time he gets to writing these letters, he'd been 50 years separated from his time with Jesus. He had time to think about what it meant. When he started finally putting pen to paper, if you will, that's not what they used, but that's what he did. He had 50 years to contemplate, what did it mean? What did my time with Jesus really mean? What are the questions that people are asking? John's gospel is very different. These letters are very different. What are the questions that I can address that people are wondering about? What is it that I can help people understand about who Jesus the man was? Because John spent time with him. He was an old man with experience as a pastor of a local church, and he had had all these other titles that he had held. He had experience, age, and wisdom. And when we read John's writings, experience, age, and wisdom come through so clearly along with his personal experience with Jesus. John's referred to as the beloved disciple and the disciple whom Jesus loved. Both of those are probably phrases that he used himself so that he didn't use his own name to make it sound like bragging or like he was more arrogant than he wanted people to think he was. He just wanted to be identified, and so he did it in a way not to use his own name. It could be in part that there was this close relationship with Jesus because John's mother Salome and Jesus' mother Mary were sisters. Did you know that one? John and Jesus were cousins. First cousins. And it's kind of cool because in Luke 9, Jesus refers to James and John as the sons of thunder, because they had asked at one point if they should call down from the heavens a torrential storm almost. And Jesus said, no, we'll take care of it a different way. He was passionate. And that comes through. So you've got James and John and Peter that are really the three disciples that seem to know Jesus the best. They were the ones that had the most upfront, up-close, personal, front-row seat time with Jesus. It didn't seem to help Peter, though, when it came time just before Jesus' death, when he denied even knowing Jesus, not once, but three times. So sometimes how well you know someone isn't a predictor for how you're going to behave or how you're going to live or act. John, however, knew Jesus well. He knew him personally. Think about it. We're going to spend the next few weeks studying a book from a guy that writes it to a church because he's got some concerns and some care about them that he wants to make sure that gets across, but he actually knew Jesus personally. We're not reading a book about, you know, people that have ideas or theories or thoughts about it. This guy knew him. This guy knew Jesus personally. So the Gospel of John is all about the life of Jesus. Those to whom Jesus ministered, the people who Jesus talked to, the later letters of John 1, 2, and 3 are specific letters to a specific church that John was very well acquainted with. It seems that it was the church in the city of Ephesus. Now, if you've ever traveled the world, there's one thing about Ephesus that's curious. Ephesus doesn't really have Christians anymore. And yet John pastored the church. And in fact, in John's book of Revelation, we're going to read this in just a minute. In John's book of Revelation, the first letter of warning and encouragement to one of the seven churches is to the church in Ephesus. But if you go there today, 99.8% of the country of Turkey, including Ephesus, where Ephesus is located, is Turkey, 99.8% is Muslim. 0.2% of the population 0.2% of the population is Christian and all other religions combined. 0.2%. And that number is going down rapidly. And yet Ephesus plays such a huge part. And so this letter that ends up, this vision that John has that ends up being the book of Revelation is probably a pretty important one. So this warning, this encouragement is written to the church in Ephesus. The red letters are red. Jesus is speaking this warning. This is an important one for every church in America and the world to hear today. It says this, write this letter to the angel of the church of Ephesus. This is the message from the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands. This is the message from Jesus. I know all the things that you do. I have seen your hard work and your patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You have discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. At this point, the church is probably feeling pretty good about themselves. But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Look how far you've fallen. Turn back to me and do the works that you did at first. If you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place among the churches. But this is in your favor. You hate the evil deeds of the Nicolaitans just as I do. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. To everyone who is victorious, I will give fruit from the tree of life in the paradise of God. That's a pretty strong compliment and a pretty huge warning. People in Ephesus chose not to hear it. They chose to go on doing their own thing, and today, less than 0.2% of the population is Christian. The Christian church is non-existent. 0.2% of the people don't run around a world with another overwhelmingly populated religion making a whole lot of noise about who they are. See, John seems to be warning the church in this vision, and it happens in the book of 1 John that we're going to read today. It's like he's pleading with them to get their act together and function like the church that God has called you to be. That's a pretty important thing for all of us today. Churches have all these ideas of great mission statements and great things that they're going to accomplish, but if they're not accomplishing the Great Commission, was to go, therefore, tell all the world about Jesus, baptizing them, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded, and then teaching them to be disciples. If we're not doing that, we're missing the boat completely. And it makes us wonder what happened to the church in Ephesus. It's important to us that we stick with the being the church that God called us to be. So it's an important letter for our church, and it's an important letter for their church. Their church didn't listen. They didn't follow it. It's important that we do. The purpose of 1 John, the whole book, is laid out in 5:13. John says this, I write these things so that you may know you have eternal life. Coming after Resurrection Sunday, what's the most important thing that you can know is that Jesus is alive. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Why does it matter? Because of that, you can have eternal life. This life isn't pointless. It doesn't end when you die. Your life goes on forever. It just changes location, and you get to choose the location in this life. John wants to make sure that you know you have eternal life. In addition to speaking that word of encouragement and hope, John is addressing what seems to be a problem that's arising in this church already. It might be a little bit of a hint to what happens and the reason for their downfall. See, there seems to be false teachers. There seems to be heretical teaching. It doesn't explain it exactly, but there are people who have risen up from within the church, and they've got a message that's contrary or different or in addition to the message that God would have them preaching. And John is talking about that. Don't be led astray by those people. So this message, this letter, is an incredibly important one for our churches and Christians, not just to hear, but to heed. It isn't important to just know. It's important to do. So if you're a note taker, here's your note for right away. It is important to hear, but it is also important to heed. So here we go. 1 John chapter 2, starting in the first verse. We proclaim to you the one who existed from the beginning. That's Jesus, whom we have heard and seen. We saw him with our own eyes and touched him with our own hands. He is the word of life. John uses the word we 22 times in the first 10 verses. Do you think he's trying to develop a connection with these folks? Do you think he wants to remind them that they're not on their own and he doesn't live out on his own? He uses we 22 times, and he uses the word us all over the place. He's trying to connect himself to the people who are going to be reading this letter. He doesn't say you, he says we. He includes himself in the middle of it. It's believed that the original hearers are members of this church in Ephesus that John himself pastored. He knew them well. He knew the right things and the wrong things they were doing. He knew the good and the bad. It was a town that he had spent time in. He knew the people. It's a very personal letter. The church was pastored by a man who knew Jesus personally, face to face. Had meals with him, spent time in boats with him, traveled and walked and talked on the roads. When he says the one who existed from the beginning, it's a direct reference to his friend Jesus. Not a direct reference to somebody he didn't know or he'd heard about, but his friend Jesus. He's reminding them that Jesus had always existed from the beginning. That might be part of the heresy. That might be a part of the false teaching, because people for 2,000 years have said that Jesus is a created being. He's one of the creations of God. That's not true. Jesus has existed as God forever. Jesus wasn't created, but he came to earth in a human form. His human life had a beginning and an end. But Jesus, as God, has been around forever, will be around forever. If you go back to John's gospel, remember what it says at the very beginning, gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, the Word was already with God. The Word was God, and the Word was with God. The Word was God, and the Word was with God. Jesus has been there forever. He goes on and he reminds the people how they have heard and they have seen himself and others with their own eyes, touched his physical body, the person of Jesus. He's not made up. He's not spirit or myth or anything else. And that might be a part of the false teaching too. Jesus isn't real. He's a mythology. He's pretend. That still gets said today. That isn't true. He's saying we saw him with our own eyes and we touched him. We literally touched Jesus. That's not spirit or myth. And anybody that says that's all he did is lying. It's a false teaching. There's people today who criticize the church and criticize the gathering of church. And you know, that's lying and a false teaching, because the church is the bride of Christ. We are called to gather in fellowship as believers. The Bible even says you shouldn't give up meeting as some people do. There's a lot of false teaching, and it's all designed to tear Christians away from other Christians. Verse 2, this one is life himself. Life itself was revealed to us, and we have seen him. And now we testify and proclaim to you that he is the one who is eternal life. He was with the Father, and he was revealed to us. He calls Jesus life itself. The Bible talks about him as being the light of the world. John says he's life itself. Imagine that came from him being around him. There was something so different, so incredible, so life-changing about Jesus that he said this man is life itself. That doesn't come from just another human being. You might be really enamored by someone, but you're not going to say that that person is life itself and that they've seen him. Our faith isn't blind. It isn't misdirected. We don't believe in a myth or a fairy tale. We believe in the very real Son of God who is alive. They know the one that they believe in, and now they testify or they tell the truth about who it is that they know, that it's in Jesus alone that they have eternal life. If someone says, why in the world would you go to church on Resurrection Sunday? What's the big deal? The big deal is that Jesus was dead and now he's alive, and because he's alive, I can live forever too. Because he's alive, you can live forever too. That testimony, testifying that, is so important that we are creatures that are here for eternity. The one who is divine, the one who came from heaven, the one who has been revealed to the flesh, real body flesh. That's what John's talking about. What a privilege it is. We don't have to doubt. We don't have to wonder. We've got this first-person testimony of a guy who was there. We get to trust the testimony of someone who spent 3 years living with Jesus. And he knows that he's real. And he knows that he's really risen. And he wants to assure this church that that truth is for them. Verse 3, we proclaim to you what we ourselves have actually seen and heard so that you may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. John introduces another part of the purpose, fellowship, being together, the importance of spending time with like-minded people. If you've ever joined a club or a group or anything else, they're all affinity-based. They're all based on the same idea, the same like, the same hobby. You know, as Christians, we're affinity-based too. Our affinity is to Jesus. Our affection is to Jesus. What binds us together as a church? What we have in common is the same problem of sin and the same hope of a Savior. And he introduces this idea of fellowship, community, together, living life together, eating, talking, walking, spending time. His former church, John, and everybody else who touched and saw Jesus, and along with everyone else who believes in him now, has this fellowship that we all accept Jesus as God's Son, the one who lived and died and gave his life, was raised from the grave. But one of the things that I absolutely love most about the Christian church, it turns out it was the same thing for Jesus, is one of the hardest parts at times. It's people. One of the things you love about going to church, admit it, you love how friendly everybody is, don't you? Junior is here, he'd say, can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? You walk in here, and you know why the place is friendly? It's because you're friendly. Do you know why people look like they actually like to be here? Because you like to be here. And it's contagious. It goes around, and it's something that is more and more. It's not created. It just is there. It's catchy. There is this fellowship with each other that we have in the name of Jesus. It's why we do life groups. Outside of Sunday, in the midst of people that are like you and not like you, you get time to spend together and maybe have something to eat and study a little bit and spend time in fellowship talking about what's most important, and that's Jesus. But you know, we also find out, and John's talking about that in his warning, is the very best part of the Christian church is the people who gather can also be sometimes the ones that cause the most trouble. You know, in reality, this place and every single Christian church on earth should be the most joy-filled, enjoyable, love-filled place you ever go to. Because every church should be filled with people who are full of the joy of Jesus. John agrees with that. He goes on in verse 4 and he says this, "We're writing these things so that you may fully share our joy." Why does he use the word joy? Joy doesn't come from circumstances. Joy doesn't come from situations. Joy doesn't come from your success. Joy doesn't even come from happiness. Joy comes from our faith in Jesus and knowing that no matter whatever happens in this life, he is going to welcome us into the next. Joy comes from knowing that we are loved and cared for by the creator of the universe. Some Sundays you may come here feeling down. You might be discouraged. You might be depressed or frustrated. You know, maybe you're not feeling the joy inside of you, but you know what? If you give your chance, give yourself a chance and give God a little room to work, that joy will return to you being around other people who are full of joy. John is all about fellowship. Verse 5. This is the message we heard from Jesus. Now he's going to talk about him directly. And declare to you, God is light. There is no darkness in him at all. Going back to the Gospel of John, he is the light that shines in the darkness. There is no darkness in him at all. There's no darkness. There's no sin in Jesus. We're called to be the light of the world, but John warns us that sometimes we can get lost or we can feel lost in the darkness. And if left to ourselves, because darkness refers to sin, we truly can get lost. We can get lost in sinful thoughts and words and deeds. It's the deceit and the deception that we see in our world. That's the darkness. It's the foolishness of those who stand against God and his creation. The darkness is the opposite of God's light. It's the opposite of godliness. It's evil. It is life without fruit. Verse 6, so we are lying if we say that we have fellowship with God, but go on living in spiritual darkness. We're not practicing the truth. He's getting at two different audiences now. He's getting at these people who are lying and having deceptive teaching, but he's also getting at the hearts of the people of the church that are beginning to stray. John uses we and includes himself in this group because every one of us can get caught in darkness. He doesn't speak in an accusatory tone and say, you are living in darkness. He says we because it's true for all of us. It's true for John. It's true for you. It's true for me. If we claim that we're living in a relationship with God, and yet we continue living in spiritual darkness or sin, we're not practicing or living in the truth. And that's hard to hear because our world says, it's just a choice. Do whatever you want. If it feels good, go for it. The Bible doesn't agree with that. John says either we're living in the light or we're living in the darkness, and we really can't do both at the same time and be faithful followers of Jesus. Verse 7, but if we're living in the light as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses all from sin. John says, but, or however, if we're living in the light, growing in a relationship with Jesus, even if we fall to sin, but we're living in Christian fellowship with each other, we're trying to stay close to God and staying close to other believers, it's the blood of Jesus on the cross that cleanses us from all of our sin. That is the reason for our joy. That's why this book is so great to follow up after Resurrection Sunday. John understands the world that we live in. Verse 8, if we claim that we have no sin, we are fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. Most of us who understand what sin is, that it isn't just a mistake or an oops. Sin is breaking God's heart. It's disobeying God. It's going against God's world, going against God's word. When we understand what sin is, most of us don't deny that we're sinners. We accept that we understand that we are and that we need a Savior. But what we do is we deny the fullness of our sin. We deny what our sin really is and what it does to us. We pick and choose what we consider sinful. America's gotten great at that. And you know what we do instead? We call a little bit of harmless fun or a mistake or just a lesson to be learned. And when we do that, we deny the death of Jesus for us. We don't live in the truth of our real situation. Yeah, I'm a sinner, but I'm not that bad of one. The other guy, her, him, they're worse. Jesus is going to spend more time on them. That's not what the Bible says. See, when we don't accept the real situation that we're in, that our sin puts us in, the really dangerous thing that it does is it removes the opportunity for forgiveness. It removes the opportunity for forgiveness. When that happens, when we do that, one of the things that the Christian church is guilty of over the last few years, and And it's a scary thing because the church has really been the one who has pushed it. It's taking things that God clearly calls sinful in the Bible and declaring them to be okay or personal choices, but not sin. If anything, they're not sin. And when we're told in no uncertain terms in Scripture that they are, but we say, you know what, we read it wrong or it isn't right. The problem with that is this. I hope that you kind of see other people like me. You don't have a need to judge other people and tell them how bad they are, right? But we do have a serious responsibility to help people understand what forgiveness is and how they can be forgiven. But the thing is this, when we tell someone that their sin isn't really sin, or God didn't mean it, or God changed his mind, or we didn't understand it, something eternally dangerous happens. When you tell someone that their sin isn't sin, and they believe that, and they go on living that way, why in the world would they ever confess it as sin? If they never confess it as sin, they're never going to have an opportunity to forgive and be, for forgiveness. And so what we've actually done is we have removed the need for forgiveness by calling things something other than sin. That is an incredibly dangerous thing that the church has done. If we tell people that their sin is really just a choice and it isn't sin, even though God is so clear about what it is. Think about, for example, gossiping. Most people don't consider gossiping to be a sin. Yeah, maybe I shouldn't, but it's fun, and it's the way I get the news. It's the way I find out about everything. It's a little harmless fun. It doesn't hurt anybody. It surely isn't sin. It's all over the place. Romans 1, Paul talks about it. And for the record, this passage isn't going to feel very good, but John is talking about this stuff. Romans chapter 1, verse 28, since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, he's talking about the people of the world, they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, God abandoned them to their foolish thinking. Let them do things that should never be done. Their lives became full of every kind of wickedness. Sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. They're backstabbers and haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning. They disobey their parents. They refuse to understand. They break their promises. They're heartless and have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them. I chose that passage carefully because there's some things that aren't included in there. Because we don't need to get lost in the hot buttons of the day. What we need to do is to be clear about how God feels about sin. See, you listen to that passage, you can't dismiss it because every one of us has at least one issue that's included there. And yet what we do is we choose to fight and divide ourselves and we dissolve friendships over single issues. Families get split over single issues. And yet we're all included in that list as sinners, every single one of us. You can't listen to that list and say, not me. When we say that sin isn't sin, we're the problem. And no, you're not helping anybody. You can't love or stand up for someone and earn God's approval or favor for them. Sin is sin, and forgiveness doesn't happen without acknowledging our sin and asking for forgiveness, confessing that we understand what our sin is. That's what John is warning them of. Verse 9, if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God washes us white as snow when we confess our sin as sin. When we accept God's word as truth for our lives and live within it, God forgives our sins and washes the wickedness out of us. But when we say that it isn't sin, that wickedness just continues to grow. The darkness continues to get darker. If we claim, verse 10, if we claim we have not sinned, we're calling God a liar, and we're showing that his word has no place in our hearts. From the very beginning, you go back to the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve just wanted to be like God. So all that they wanted was to be just like God. They wanted to be their own God, and people for all of the years since, it's the same thing. We want to be our own God. We want to set our own rules. We want to call right, right, and wrong, wrong the way that we see it. It's a story as old as time. It's the cause for the original sin in the Garden of Eden. We want to name sin. We want to dismiss sin. We want to ignore sin. We want to point out the sin of others. We want to excuse ourselves and our reasons and our choices. We expect our sins to be forgiven, but we are so slow to forgive the sins of others. John opens up this, this first book, this John 1. Things like testimony and lying and fellowship and life and darkness and light and sin, forgiveness. It's all here in the first 10 verses of the book. Our entire existence on earth. What incredible summary of the reason for being a Christian and living as a Christian, as well as the stumbling blocks of being a sinner. John wants to encourage his church. John wants to help them moving toward a healthy relationship with God. I want to encourage our church. But what do you believe? Do you think that your sin is easily dismissed because you're a good person? You're better than the other people you know. You know your Bible better than them. You got more verses memorized, tucked back in your brain. Your sin isn't nearly as bad as everybody else. Do you see yourself as not a sinner? Because that's one of the illnesses that really is plaguing America today. Or do you realize, yeah, I am a sinner? See, if we realize that we're a sinner and we acknowledge our sin, we can confess it, we can ask for forgiveness, and we can change. We say that we love Jesus. Do you live like you love Jesus? Do I live like I love Jesus? Is Jesus' death for you? Or is our sin not a big enough deal to bother him? John's encouraging all believers to this church and to us today to live in the light of the love of Jesus. I'm encouraging you to live in the light of the love of Jesus. There's so much more to this short book of 1 John. It's going to take us 6 weeks to get through it. Go and read it at home. Study it. Prepare for them. Think about how you might approach the message. If you don't have a Bible, we've got these out back. We would love to send one home with you. Please grab one. Between now and then, you might be going, okay, well, how do I live in the light? How do I live as a person who believes in Jesus and is trying to live my life for him? Real simple. It's our mission statement. If you've got it memorized, and I hope you do by now, say it with me. Love Jesus. Love people. Teach people to love Jesus. You're going to find that is the summary of the book of 1 John and so much of the New Testament. That we love Jesus with everything that we are, that we love people, even the ones that are difficult to love, and that we have a desire to teach everybody out there how to love Jesus like we are, which means that we need to be the light, we need to be the example. Let's pray. God, thank you for this book of 1 John. Thank you for John and his writing, his passion, his love for you, his desire to help the people in the church of Ephesus not face the fate that they ended up choosing to face because the church is gone now. There's essentially no Christians left in Ephesus. And God, we don't want that to be the story of our lives, our families, our churches, our state. And so God, we need to pay attention to this book. We need to pay attention to that letter to the church in Ephesus. They were good people. They had good deeds. They did a lot of good things. But they forgot to love you first. And so God, our mission statement begins with love Jesus. We never want to forget our first love, and Jesus, you are our first love. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand. You are in for a treat. Our young people have taken over the platform, and they are going to lead you in two songs of worship. I'll invite our ushers to come forward. While you get to worship the first one with them, I want to say thank you for being a part of contributing to the ministry that is reaching our communities with the love of Jesus and reaching the world. We have been called to a mission, and we are serious about carrying it out. Thank you for being a part of it. Thank you for your generosity. Let's worship.
There is healing in the power.
It must be okay. Max smiled. That's the okay. That's the all okay sign. Thank you. We got one more before you go home. Hey, here's the deal. We're going to go through our mission statements. You maybe go, what can I do this week that's going to make a difference? It's really simple. Love Jesus, love people, teach people to love Jesus. You ready? Love Jesus, love people, teach people to love Jesus. You can change the world around you by doing that. If your focus goes off of you and off of the other person, and if your focus goes on Jesus and you share that with someone, you will literally change not just their life, but their eternity. Love Jesus, love people, teach people to love Jesus. Thanks for coming, everybody. Hope you have a great week. See you next Sunday. One more for the road from you. Thank you very much. So my wife, the worship leader, had one announcement for me to make this morning. I forgot first service. I can't forget second service. Night of worship right here, April 28th, 6 p.m. Thank you, guys. It is not easy standing up in front of all these people, but they're a very friendly audience, and you did an amazing job. Thank you very much.
How sweet the sound once lost. took my place with your grace on top of grace.